Frida, we are live. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Welcome back for the last final day of the CIDSAI 2021 conference. We had a very interesting, thought-provoking open house session moderated by Sohir, and I'm sure you all are already putting in your many more questions into that channel. Today we have four talks in the morning session by Piyush, Ajay, Vinayak and Paul. And we have our first speaker, Piyush, who is going to talk to us on bird collisions with buildings in India, a synthesis of current knowledge. Piyush, welcome and good morning. Piyush is a disaster management specialist. He has a master's in architecture and an MPhil in geography. He has been involved directly in a rain gauging exercise in Pune since last year, and we heard him in the first day of this conference, a very interesting study indeed. He's currently working as a consultant in the domains of environment, disaster management and development. So Piyush, the floor is all yours and let us start.
And we acknowledge the help from Neha Panchami RSQ Pune, Jayanti Kalam ARRC Bangalore, and Asmita Patwardhan. So the story actually literally starts with a thud. Yeah, actually not dramatic enough the way I described it, but I was sitting in a common dining space in Honey Valley in Coorg. This was over 10 years back, and we were shocked by something that we thought was equivalent to the building collapsing. Half the people ran out. I moved instinctively towards the source of the sound and I saw this imprint on the window. And I stepped out to see this. A beautiful emerald dove dead instantly. High speed collision, terrible death and terrible experience. And all the more shocking because when you look at the building, which was the source of its death, it looks like a very simple, straightforward local building. And the bird actually hit into the glass panes on the left. So this, in a way, this set me thinking, but didn't really get into anything for very long with the Global Bird Rescue Week last year serving as a trigger. The question is, why do birds crash into glass? The birds don't see the world as we do. The reflection in the glass or the fact that it's see-through gives them an impression that they're flying into open space. This is actually a very large problem, not so much so in India, or at least we don't know of it, but up to a billion birds are supposed to be dying every year in the United States alone. And interestingly, about 44% up to 3 stories height, and another 56% from 4 to 11 stories, basically meaning that high rises per se, or at least the lower floors are the ones that really play a role, and of course, everyday buildings, like the one we saw in Coorg. What is the magnitude of the problem for India? So the fact is that we are presenting here today the first piece of work that has been done for India. And the magnitude may not seem large, but that's primarily because it's barely studied. Now, interestingly, we have a lot of data points for birds in India. eBird is 25 million data points in India alone and growing exponentially every day. So we basically decided to use existing data on social media like Facebook, citizen science portals, and we use words like thud, crash, pain, window, facade, dead, injure. And we also got data from Rescue Pune, and ARRC Bengaluru. So all this put together, we came across 112 observations covering 51 species, which is about 4% of India's bird diversity. And there are bird collisions all over. The map basically has a bias toward where there are maximum data points in the country. But there are bird collisions all over is what we think. There are also rare species like the Malayan night heron and the rufous bellied eagle, the broadbill, amongst other more common species. Most collisions in North America are during migration, whereas in India, other than two species, we don't really see any seasonal pattern as such. For these two species, which is the black-backed dwarf kingfisher and the Indian pitta, which comprise 23% of the total collisions, there clearly is autumn migration period where the collisions are maximum. How does this compare with results from other parts of the region? There's a very good study from Singapore, and there are some similar trends. Autumn migration is the time when species of pitta and dwarf kingfishers are worst hit. And interestingly, most of these readings come from a pre-skyscraper Singapore. And so re-emphasizes that it's often buildings at a lower height, which play a very important role in bird hits. A quick case study from Pune. At the edge of Pune, a growing city, birds slam into a glass which defines the urban parapet. And Asmita decides to find a solution, comes across something interesting in the form of silhouettes in Greece, and ends up with decorative glass film and solves the problem. Now, the basic thing that worked, which Asmita was not aware of, is the 2x4 rule, which was published way back in 1990, which basically says that birds will find that the glass panes are obstructions if there is something at 2 inches interval horizontally or 4 inches interval vertically. And these are some products here in the images that you can see that are found in the West, bird tapes and other products. Internationally, work has been happening for close to 30 years now. And you can see that there are standards now in certain countries like Canada and the US. And there are also important steps being taken by large city councils like New York. So this is finally making some impact in the West. Now, the question here is, the incidences that we came across in 2012, are they isolated or are they part of a larger phenomenon? We find that while remote, rural, and the urban fringe that seems to coincide with bird-rich areas, does it indicate that the urban core actually has already lost all the species that are prone to bird hits? The determining factor definitely seems to be the increased use of glass, but perhaps in areas where glass was not found earlier. Unless there isn't greater awareness of the problem and a clear implementable solution that is aesthetically acceptable, the problem is likely to grow. Join us. Bird watchers play an important role, and they can even in this. You can report bird collision in eBird by typing hashtag bird hit. We've got a iNaturalist page up there. Created for bird collisions. We currently just have 7 readings, and please come on board and help increase the number of readings. And importantly, just around the corner from the 27th of September to 3rd of October is the Global Bird Rescue Week. Bird Count India is leading the effort in India. Join us, which for birds that are found dead, unfortunately, or injured from bird hits. And I can assure you that this is really a space where a lot of work needs to be done. And it's not a completely hopeless situation. We can find solutions. We already have solutions globally. And I would like to end on a positive note. This is actually an image that I took off Facebook from the page of Madhurima Das, who reported a bird hit. And actually, after taking care of the bird and allowing to get some rest, the bird actually flew away. So it's not completely a lost case, but we need more data. Thank you very much on behalf of Piyush, Ashwin, Neha, Jayanti, and Asmita. Thank you. Goodbye.
So that was an excellent presentation. Please do put your questions in the thread created for Piyush. And we do have a couple of questions, one of them which Piyush has already asked about glass film strips, and he said that they are not available in India. We have a question from Nishant, and he says that, do you think it is more in West such incidents are recorded, and here in India, is it less awareness about it?
Yeah, so I think the problem definitely is most significant in the West, and there's a different pattern which is linked to the migration. So there's an intensity of bird hits during the migration period, and the visibility of these is higher also because people are actually going out and sort of surveying areas where bird hits happen. In India, the fact is that there's been virtually no work. We haven't come across any work on this in India, and very little work in parts of the world other than the US and Europe. So I think it's probably an issue which is still in its initial phases, but I feel that we simply don't know enough to be able to say anything conclusively. And hence, I think that the problem is greater than we think, and is only going to get more serious as we go along.
Okay. I think we are just going to have more questions coming in slowly, but Ram is requesting you that if you can post a link to the 3M film as well. So, I just wanted to know, Piyush, there are a lot of bird hits even near the airports and things like that. So do you think that something is needs to be done around that area where very often it leads to a lot of problems with the aircrafts and stuff like that. So have you ever thought about those?
So I personally haven't worked on bird hits with respect to aircrafts, but that is an area where a lot of work has happened for the simple reason that it's a matter of security and a very high cost to life and property. But this problem is different in the sense that the drivers of the problem is different. It's called bird hits, but it's a completely different setting. And I think that we as a community of bird watchers, interested in this space, we need to probably look at this more specifically and at least to start with generate more data.
We have one more question from Nishant. There is a habit of bird feeders and bird baths in West. Is this also a contributing factor?
Right. So when we look at the literature in the West, there are reports where birds that come to feeders and such attractions close to buildings, in the absence of any protective sort of taping on certain glass panes, they do end up flying out into these glass panes. But the larger contributing factor seems to be more the flyways that the birds use and the buildings that are in them, including the fact that the buildings have glass panes and they are lit from the inside, and that attracts birds into them as they're flying. So the problem in the West is actually better defined, and it seems also different from what we've come across in our study in India.
Thank you, Piyush. I'm sure many more questions are on the way, so please stay on and do answer them on Slack while we move on to our next speaker for today. We have we have the next speaker who will talk to us on avifauna data collection in Madhya Pradesh through bird surveys, and he is Ajay Gadikar. He is an IT entrepreneur and an avid bird watcher based in Indore, an active member of the NGO, the Nature Volunteer. He takes a lot of interest in creating awareness about nature and conservation among children. In 2012 and 2013, he was honored by the Forest Department for his efforts to conserve the depleting avifauna in the Malwa region. So let's have Ajay, and welcome Ajay for the morning talks.
Hi everyone, I am Ajay Gadikar, a bird watcher from Indore, and today I'll be speaking about the avifauna data collection efforts that's going on in the state of Madhya Pradesh, mostly in the protected areas, by organizing various bird surveys. So basically, since we all know that the protected areas are come under the Forest Department, and to organize any bird survey there, one have to have the consent from Forest Department. And the Forest Department, when they are going for such surveys in big areas, they require the help of many NGOs so that they can collect the data in a shorter period of time. So it's an effort in which the management of that park is in collaboration with an NGO doing it. And with the entry of the NGO, many volunteers are able to participate in such survey. And as we all know that apart from the 6 tiger reserves, there are many national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. So this is successfully going on since recent years. And till now, almost all of those are covered and we have a baseline data of all of them. So how it started was that in 2016, during the vulture estimation at Panna Tiger Reserve, as you all know that Panna landscape has been known for good population of vultures. So in 2010, the vulture estimation was taken with the help of many volunteers. The volunteers from all over the country were called upon, and they helped the Forest Department in collating the data. And it resulted into a nice exercise, and the data that came out was also more exhaustive. And since it was successful, it was then carried out for 5 regular continuous years. And that set up the part that how volunteers and citizens, scientists can help in any of this exercise. So from there onwards, in 2016 and thereafter, all the different national parks and sanctuary management themselves initiated this thing. They, with the help of an NGO, started the exercise of taking stock of what avifauna they have in their area. And then continuously this exercise is going on, and volunteers are participating in all these bird surveys, and from all these areas, we are having a baseline data of the avifauna. The methodology and protocols that are used in surveys are more or less same. I mean, volunteers are called upon, and once they are selected, they are formed in different teams with some senior birder and some junior, and they are sent to all the areas of the park and where they go on to bird. And then they come up with their data, and they document the data in the eBird app, which is well recognized. And this way, in a shorter span of time, whole of the park is covered and we get a data from that. And a beautiful thing that's been happening apart is that in this bird survey, some senior ornithologist has been called upon in many of these surveys, who actually take lectures before the start of the survey, in which he tried to tell volunteers how to identify birds, what are the identifying techniques, how to take the data, and also he helps in evaluation, in validation later on. And apart from that, he also tells us about how to handle an injured bird. So the forest department, the ground staff, I mean, who is in the field, and volunteers are able to know that even if they came across some injured bird, how to rescue it and how to handle it. What are the main outcomes? The surveys are going on continuously. The data that has been captured through the surveys, first of all, it tells about the overall bird diversity of that area and what are the new species that has been found there, that has been also documented. And also in the Panna, when the vulture data was taken for 5 successive years, it also revealed that the vulture counts are more or less stable and on a slight rise. So that is also known when that survey was done for a successive 5 years. And most of those sites where this survey are going on are IBA sites also. So the data that is captured is also important in helping the proper advocacy for any future conservation plans of this species. Also, through these surveys, we come to know about various important congregating and roosting sites of birds, which is very important to know when you are doing any conservation exercise. As we all know that Madhya Pradesh has 47 threatened bird species, so data regarding that also come and which is helpful in case there is any threat to further threat to these birds, remedial actions can be done. Also, I would like to point out the statewide vulture survey, which is done centrally from Bhopal, from the headquarters, in which every district of the state has been covered in that vulture survey. It has been every 2 years. It has been, conducted every 2 years, in which a lot of volunteers from all over the country participates, and it's been done thrice till now. So, and it revealed that in 2016, the vulture population that was 6,900. Has come up to 9,100 in year 2021. So this is the statewide survey, and it is really helping to know the vulture status in the state. The future course is of this surveys is like to conduct the surveys in the same protected area consistently every year, so that any increase and decrease over the period or a longer period of time must be known. Then conducting multiple surveys in a single year in all the seasons, that is also important, so that whole of the bird diversity can be known. At Alamandal Sanctuary, it's done already, and at CUNY Sanctuary, it's been proposed. And apart from that, the main task is the data that has been coming from all these protected areas, this has to be collected, and a comprehensive data bank has to be made of all this, which needs to be done. And then after this exercise done in protected areas, it has to be moved on to other potential areas also. In MP, there are many potential areas and the NGOs now are contacting with the respective district forest officers, and they are doing it and are proposed to do it at a more bigger level. So these are something that we need looking forward. And lastly, I'll tell you that through the volunteers and citizen scientists joining hands with the forest department, we are getting a very good win-win situation, The management of the park is able to know what all avifauna is there in their backyard. Then the ground forest staff also gets enriched immensely when they interact with bird watchers traveling all over the country. And the new volunteers which are joining in such surveys also get interaction with seniors, and they know how their contribution, and they are also are immensely happy in doing this. And it's an excellent example that how citizen science can help in contributing a cause. And finally, this is a photograph of Kuno National Park. where in coming months the cheetah is expected to arrive. It's an photograph in which every participants were present, and it shows that how this effort is going on. So I'd like to thanks everybody for listening me, and the forum is now open for any questions. Thank you very much.
So, Ajay, very interesting work that you are doing in Madhya Pradesh. And I know that there is a lot of interest from the Forest Department as well to partner on this initiative. So we have a few questions which are coming up for you. And the first one is from Nishan. And he's asking you if which are the species of vultures seen in Panna? Is this exercise open for public, and generally at what time? How can people get to know about this?
Yeah, in Panna, this exercise was carried out from 2010 to 2015. Right now, it is now a part of a statewide survey. So specifically in Panna, there is no vulture survey in recent years. So, but one can take part in the survey, which is done at state level all over the MP, when where every district is open, and it's open for everybody, anybody who want to participate from the country. So it happens in February every year. So one has to look into some groups, some bird watching groups, or somewhere in the social media where this announcement has been made. So every twice, on the every second year it's been done.
Okay. We have another question from Kannan. He says that it's heartening to see the vulture count increasing. Did you analyze species-wise breakup for the past 3 years?
Yeah, of the what Nishant has asked, I forget what vultures are found in Panna. So yes, there are seven out of the 9 species that are found in country. 7 are seen in Panna, and the question that vulture population, I mean there is a breakup being done, that how the species has thriving, I mean each species. So that is a very exhaustive study being done. I mean district wise, how many vulture counts are there, then specifically what are every district wise also, which are performing well. So that data is there, I mean, and it's been published data that which vulture species are doing it. And it's mostly the long-billed vulture and the jay, which are increasing their count. Also the white rump, but mostly the king vulture numbers are stagnant, I would say.
Just a minute. Yeah. So there's another question which is, just a minute, I seem to have lost the thread. Just a moment. It would be Mital is asking, it would be helpful if the Forest Department and the organizers who plan vulture counts put more efforts in training the volunteers, forest guards to identify vulture species, train on methods of counting and how to trap, how to use the app, etc. Otherwise, the data coming from these surveys can be poor. So you have anything to comment on that? It's a comment from Mital.
Yeah. I mean, earlier when the vulture counts were done only by the Forest Department, I had an example when this they themselves used to count. They used to, there are so poor data. I mean, had counted black kites as a juvenile of Egyptian vultures, and in Indore district they come up with some 240 vulture this thing, and I was just shocked to see that, because I know there are hardly 15 Egyptian vultures. So first of all, they are actually, it is good that they are incorporating NGOs into it and volunteers, so that at least that level of that level of error get minimized. Now this, the second point is the volunteers that are coming also need to be, I mean, educated to identify the correct thing. So in many of the surveys, we are on the first day, we are trying to call an ornithologist who can initially can take a lecture as how to identify the vultures. But again, I'll say that vultures are difficult species to identify them, and there are juveniles and subspecies. So it requires more of training and that. And obviously, the more better evaluation will be done at first stage, the more better it will be. So it's a process going on. I hope.
So I think we have time for about just one question from Pankaj, and he's saying, excellent work, Ajay. Do you see this model being taken up by other states? And two, does this also get results in local persons getting into birding?
It has been a tremendous success. I mean, I don't know about the other states being will be able to take it or not. I just want to say that it's after this bird counts and birds census surveys, now the department is so enthusiastic that they're coming up with butterfly surveys as well. So that is a one thing. I mean, at least they are looking for such kind of openings with NGOs and peoples. And I'm looking forward to being a key member in all this organizing team. So, I forget the main part of what Piyush asked.
No, so he has asked that, does this also result in local persons getting into birding, and whether the model is taken up by other states?
Yeah, so the states I don't know, but yes, local forest guards and all the staff that come in contact with all these birders, really they get really benefited. I mean, some of them has been now good birders because they know that people are coming from so long to see this thing, and which I look every day. So they at least 2-4% of them are really converted into a real good bird watchers, and are in contact with all of us.
Just, I think there's a question from Prabhakar. He says that, do you also campaign on pesticide usage and that caused the decrease of vulture population? Are you monitoring this as well?
There is no specific, thrust on this thing, but whenever there is a survey and whenever there is an introduction section, it's been told that why vulture population has drastically come down and what is the reason. And all the volunteers that they come there at least know that particular thing. And although in those 2 days or 3 days of survey, it's not possible to actually go on field and educate. But yes, it is at least through that, the forest guards and the chokidars and all the forest staff, they come to know, and they in turn can replicate it in their areas that don't use this pesticide within this thing. So time and again, it's been pressure. I mean, it's been thrusted.
Okay. So I guess this is the final question for you, Ajay. Thank you so much. And please stay on. I'm sure there'll be many more questions for you in the Slack channel. So kindly answer them over there. We will move on to our next third speaker for the morning talks. We have Vinayak Hegde, who is going to talk to us on evidence of life stage and even specific responses of Danaus butterflies to rising temperatures, a very interesting topic that he has taken up. Vinayak is a research assistant at Kriya University. He is currently working with citizen science data and has worked with WWF in the conservation field. He has a degree in evolutionary and behavioral ecology. He has also been on working on plain tiger species using citizen science data. He's also trying to look at trends in development of the butterflies with respect to temperature. Very interesting indeed. So let's...
Hello, everyone. Today, I'll be sharing some of our results from our recent study on Danaus butterflies' responses to rising temperatures. Climate change, as we all are familiar with, has been causing numerous consequences in the environment, one of them being global rise in average temperature over the last 50 years, as you can see, And this in turn, this has led to biodiversity loss in turn affecting different species. For instance, insects make up more than 2/3 of existing species. With changing temperatures have effects in number of ways on them, a few of them being movement of animals in search of suitable conditions, causing shift in distribution and shift in timing of plants, blooming and emergence of insects. Also change in flight activity patterns and migration behavior. Ectotherms such as butterflies rely on the surrounding temperatures to regulate their body temperature, which means the effect of rising temperature could have direct and severe impact on them. In this study, we asked if occurrence records submitted by citizen scientists show butterflies' response to rising temperature. We looked at occurrence records from citizen scientists' data, and we found that it's possible as temperatures rise, butterflies could move. One possibility is that temperatures rise, butterflies shift in distribution and occurrence at temperature similar to past temperatures. And also alternatively, as temperatures rise, butterflies may begin to occur at higher temperatures. It's possible these responses differ based on the life stages. Adults and larvae could have varying responses, and events like mating also might occur at higher temperatures. We addressed these questions using three milkweed species. First being Danaos crispus, also known as plain tiger, and common tiger or Danaos genutia, and monarch or Danaos plexippus. So all the three species are widespread on a similar latitude, and a good amount of citizen science data is available on them. The species also have been studied for decades, which will help us look at large scale effects and shifts over time. First step in our data collection was to search for all observations that were submitted for plain tiger and common tiger from 2011 to 2020 in India. And for monarch, we looked at Mexico. We had to subsample the amount of data we extracted for Mexico because we had a very huge sample size. The search was also limited to research grade observations and observations with images. The data extracted included date of observation, the coordinate, then time of submission, and the multimedia link to the observation. The observation with the species were then marked for the sex of the butterfly and the life stage of the butterfly, if it was an adult or a larvae, and what event it was involved in, and also the number of individuals in the image. We also marked egg and pupae life stages, but then we had to discard them due to very few sample size. The second part of our data extraction was to obtain temperature data, where we used Copernicus Climate Data Store for it. And we used a data set known as ERA5 Monthly Average Temperature, where we extracted 2 meter temperature, which was temperature about 2 meters from land surface for each occurrence record. And the resolution we used was 9 kilometer by 9 kilometer grid. As you can see the distribution maps here, these were all the data points of the observations we used in the study. This was for plain tiger and common tiger in India, and monarch for Mexico. From our analysis, we saw an annual rise in temperature for all the three species every year, which was the reason we wanted to see if there was an increase in temperature of occurrence. As you can see in this graph, on the y-axis, we have monthly average temperature, and on the x-axis, we have the temperature. And three columns, one for each species, Crispus, Genutia, and Plexippus, and two rows, adult and larvae. From this graph, we can say the average temperatures for each species differ, with Chrysippus having the highest highest temperature of occurrence, and Genusia and Plexippus having slightly lower temperature. Across all the three species, occurrence of temperature increases for adults. It is not the same case for larvae. For larvae, it was mostly the occurrence of temperature is either similar or lower over the years. And for Genusia, because of the low sample size, we cannot come to this inference. And also, these observations were from random places. We don't have a continuous record, and which is why it was important to see how temperatures at particular site differed from average temperature over the decade for that site and month. Hence, a difference, average monthly temperature difference from decade's median was taken. And over the years, occurrences at higher temperature than the decade's median monthly average temperature for that site of occurrence. The median line here suggests the temperature is the same as the decades from the decadal median. And the points above is higher temperature than the decadal median, and the points below are lower temperature than the decadal median. It is interesting to see there is a steep slope for Plexippus that shows a higher increase in temperature over the decade. Similarly, we looked at if there was any effect of temperature on mating events, and we could see a positive slope for Chrysippus, very close to significant, and with more data, it would help us to understand this relationship better. And we can conclude that there is a stage and species specific response to temperature of occurrence rising over time, and responses is different for the life stages, adult and larvae. And as we see steeper slope for Plexippus, it suggests it would be important to explore these species that occur at different temperatures. And this also shows how valuable citizen science data is to understand occurrence, and how events could also have an effect with rise in temperature. As we saw, Chrysippus mating occurs at higher temperature over time. Also, studying butterfly taxa to understand large scale patterns would be important, as butterflies are important bioindicators for climate change. Since this is an ongoing project, we hope to explore the data more and draw more conclusions of it. We would finally like to thank our funding CREA Faculty Research Fellowship and our interns, and of course the citizen scientists teams involved in the work they do, and all the website which offer the temperature data openly. Thank you.
So Vinayak, excellent work, very interesting area that you have gone into for the temperature. There is a comment by Prabhakar. He says that we could not do such studies without large databases on occurrences from SITSAI records. Nice work. And then he goes on to ask another question. Why did you not go to GBIF and source the data, which aggregates data from many initiatives?
We did look at GBIF. I think one of the reasons we looked at iNaturalist is because of the information we could extract from the multimedia link itself. That was clearly the ease of data we got from iNaturalist. That was the reason to go only for iNaturalist.
So you are going to get many more questions, and we'll wait for those. And in the meantime, if you want to add something more other than what you have already stated, maybe you could give us some comments on something which you may have missed out here.
So in the presentation, we showed results for monthly average data. We have also extracted hourly data. We are still running analysis on that. And we have extracted other biovariables such as total precipitation and humidity. So that is also something we are still running analysis on.
So Nishant has another question. He says it's an interesting thought. Is there any other species of butterflies that you choose monarch on which study is happening? Like, why did you choose monarch on which studies, such studies are happening?
So initially we chose plain tiger and common tiger. Reason we also wanted to look at monarch was, like I mentioned, because of the similar latitudes they are found in. That's why we picked monarch as well.
Okay. There's a question here from Suhail. What would you infer from your graphs with positive slopes if the temperatures are increasing in each of the sites, and if the butterflies stay exactly where they are, then you would expect a positive slope over time, correct? Or am I misunderstanding?
Yeah, that is the reason we looked at the decadal medium to see if the temperature is actually increasing at all sites and at all months, which is why we are seeing a positive slope. But again, since this is not a continuous record of the occurrence, we cannot fully concluding saying yeah, the temperatures at which the butterflies exist is increasing. Maybe with more data and with more continuous occurrence record, we can conclude that.
Ram has a question. He's asking a non-climate change question. Are there any migrations in Indian Danis butterflies?
I am not sure, but since they're so widespread, they're present in like a wide range of temperatures from what literature review we have done. I'll have to look at that for that question. I'll get back to that on Slack.
Sure. Okay. Thank you, Vinayak. I'm sure there are going to be more questions, so you will answer them in the channel as and when they come. We will move on to our next speaker for the final talk for the morning session. We have Paul, and he is going to talk to us on an investigation into the spatio-temporal patterns of the Himalayan vagrant butterfly. So another butterfly session. Paul is a junior research fellow at the Government College Bilaspur in Himachal Pradesh. He is using science data as a minor supplement for several aspects of his current study in the Western Himalayas. Paul is a proponent of more public participation in scientific research, open access data and open access software, so that scientific research is within everyone's reach, not just for academics. Wonderful thought. And take it away from you.
Hi, my name is Paul, and I'll be taking you through my investigation into the species and the patterns of the Himalayan vagrant butterfly. I seek to solve the puzzle of whether the species had undergone range expansion, range shift, or if it's just a case of vagrancy. Starting, I'll give you a brief background of the species. They are found as far west as the Jammu and Kashmir and as far east as the French Polynesia in the Pacific Oceans. But this specific subspecies are found as far east as the Hong Kong, especially around this region. And they fall under the Nymphalidae family, which is the bush-footed family of butterflies. In India, they're distributed across the Himalayan range from west to east and some pockets in central and southern India along the eastern coast. And outside of India, they're also found in Himalayan region like Nepal and Bhutan, and also Southeast Asia, like till Thailand and parts of South China. As you can see from the picture, here, the easternmost portion is eastmost record is from Hong Kong, and southernmost point is from Thailand, and northern and westernmost point is Jammu and Kashmir. Same thing is can be seen in the flat projected map. So, in the background of the research, why is there a need for studying this species and trends and patterns of the species? This species is not particularly threatened or rare across the range. Instead, that this species could act as a model for future research. But for me, it is out of curiosity to understand why there is an increase in records in the westernmost part of the range in the last 5-6 years, and why there are gaps in the range. So the question that is to this current investigation has been, one, has there been any range shift to the westernmost part of the range? Two, are they migrating upwards across the range due to climate change? And three, how reliable are sea science data for distance ecological questions? By sea science data, I'm referring to the data group through public participation in scientific research. This is commonly referred to as citizen science, and alternatively known as community science or trout science or evocational science. All of them contain the word sea, so I just put the word sea in science and made a new term for it. And it can be enough of those or none of these, depending on what you want to refer it to. So the people who participate in sea science are known as sea scientists or just scientists without S. Sorry for the digression, but now we move on to the data, which is 55% of the data I grouped are from published literature and communication with the authors of such literature, most of them being peer-reviewed and some peer literature as well. And in terms of sea science, around 36% of the data comes from sea science, and most of it from the participation website. And these are the 5 personal records I got from Jaipur district. These are the first records from that district in Himachal, and more than half of the most western portion are from my current research, which was as part of the high spatial distribution phenology mapping of fly captures. And methodology I used were, first I used quality filters, removing coordinates with high coordinate uncertainty from the state, and data which were repeated or low quality. And I tried to retain as much data as possible. Like, for example, when there was a range of dates given, I took the median date for increasing data point. Elevation dates derived for Google points for the coordinates itself, and different buffers were used for extracting means. In terms of coordinate uncertainty, a coordinate uncertainty of 0.5 and 5 are used as buffers, and as for DDM data, which is of 30 meter resolution, by correlations were run between different dates, longitude, latitude, navigation, adoption channels, after checking for anomalies under separable test, QQ plots, and scatter plots. Comparison between various methods of extraction and use of sea science were also done. So, this is just the coordinates overlaid over the most last layer. Now we'll address the first question, which is whether Hadiyama undergone a range extension shift or vagrancy. As you can see, there is no significant correlation, either in experiments or candidate strand correlation. They can see there is nothing significant. So the, it implies that there is no linear positive or negative correlation between the dates and that. So vagrancy is also unlikely due to the repeated sightings in the last half a decade. So, and also because of sampling bias, I feel that the places in the westernmost range are very understudied. Range extension is the most likely explanation for this. No latitudinal shift was located. So, if it was a westernmost shift, it would have been change in longitude, correlation between longitude and depth. And so, that was part of the study. And so, these are the dates under different scenarios. The date values of 40,000 corresponds to around 2009, as you can see in the left text box. So this means that after 2009, there was a lot of data that we collected, but before that, there was a scarcity of data, especially pre-2000. So we need more people contributing to that. This is the histogram of longitude. From 75 to 80 degree longitude, we have the Uttarakhand and Himalayas, the Himachal Pradesh, and Jammu and Kashmir, so there's a small peak over there, and the high peak is from 90 to 95 degrees, which contains a lot of northeast India. In terms of latitude, we can see a peak from 25 to 30, which is including rains from northeast India to parts of Uttarakhand, which includes Nainital. So, as for months were distributed, the month S4 means that the these are, the actual dates, months that were derived from the data. So in GCNT, there is a peak in the Mars, and then a peak from 8 to, that is August to end of the year. So there's a bimodal distribution, and they're more active during that time. And to address the second question, has there been a climbing, have there been climbing up over the years? Data indicates that they are not. There's a very insignificant correlation. So this would mean that there has been no, either climbing up or climbing down. But the p-values are somewhat high, which means that we need more sample size to confirm this phenomenon. But generally speaking, this there has been no climbing up or climbing down. And these are elevations under different scenarios. You can look at the top box and you can see that the elevations, the means of elevations derived using scenario 1, which is directly from Muller, and scenario 2, which is 2 and 3, which is using means from the Aster GDM data. They are kind of different, so one must look at the uncoordinate certainty when using the data for the research and the biological relevance of how the uncertainty affects the correlations. So these are the frequencies of elevation. You can see that there are two major peaks from 200, 0 to 200 and from 600 to 800. So these are the places where you are more likely to encounter the species. Inferences of this, as I explained, as there is no significant second question. And, moving on to the third question, how does sea science extraction of sea science data affect the conclusions or results? So you can see that in the case of correlation of the elevation from Google Earth versus the one that is with the buffer, just means you can see the correlation is 0.85. So it's good correlation, but it's not perfect. And as we increase uncertainty, which is up to 5 kilometer buffer, which is 5 kilometer radius buffer, you can see that the point it reduces to 0.8, and the confidence interval is the lowest interval is around 0.68. So lowest part of the interval is 0.68. This is a cause for concern. And then another kind of test was done, which was using the coordinates that are derived from the names that are available on the Butterfly Scientific website versus the one that was received using received. So the distance between them was compared, and the mean was arrived at, and the mean was found to be 7.8 kilometers. So the difference in coordinates and distance in coordinates between both of these two methods of extraction of coordinates is highly significant, because the biological daily dispersal is around 1 to 5 kilometers for the specific species. So it will affect, it's likely to affect the data if the data that was derived using just the names that are used. So, but this is not going to affect research like species distribution modeling, especially in models such as maximum entropy. Now we'll discuss about problems with the data and WE solution. There's lack of reporting of the coordinate inaccuracy, which is absolutely necessary when dealing with very specific studies that need a lot of spatial resolution. So we always submit coordinates along with coordinate inaccuracy. And second problem is the difficulty in extracting coordinates, because the old names are given, names are too broad to pinpoint, coordinates are incorrectly given. And this can be remedied by giving specific locations with habitat information, record coordinates in decimals, and that will review data, both by reviews as well as the authors and curators of any groups. The problem is that there is a problem with correspondence, the lower response rate. It was around 50% of, for around half the papers I requested data for. I only received around, it was only around 50%, so that was bad. That is pathetic response rate. And in some of the literature, there's a lack of corresponding email address, which is permanent. Permanent email address like Gmail can be used instead of institutional mail, which changes over time. Since we are trying to correspond with all this of papers which hasn't published at least a decade ago or even earlier. And we need more responsive corresponding authors. And fourth problem is lack of reporting of exact dates. Exact dates need to be reported along with time if possible. Some portals don't even collect timestamp information, which is bad practice, since that's valuable information that can be used. So, and going to the last problem, there is a lot of time wasted in extracting data from papers. I spend around 3 weeks just to collect data from 30-40 papers. So That's a lot of time wasted. It could have been submitted in the C-Science repository or portal or given as a supplementary material. So there's a lot of data getting, collecting dust in the field notebooks of people. So it's better to always submit all of that, right? And I acknowledge all these people for helping with the data. That's all, folks. So if they have any questions, shoot for them. Thank you
for listening. Thank you, Paul. There is a lot of interesting work, but I think that there's something wrong with the audio. So there are a lot of people mentioning that. Would you very quickly want to say a few words, maybe some key findings, and then maybe we'll ask a few questions which are already on the channel?
Sorry about the video. I think it's because of my earphone moved around while I recorded. Yeah. So the basic findings are that I wanted to see if the vagrant butterfly across the range was shifting towards the western part. Because of the records we have been finding, people have been finding in the past half a decade. So the result for this is that I couldn't find any significant correlation for that. There is no shift. So it's most likely a range extension, or it's simply that the species has not been recorded properly in the western part of the range. But that is not very likely, since there have been surveys which happened here, not as much as we should be having. And also I checked if the species have been climbing up the elevation in response to climate change. That also yielded a negative result, so there is no, I couldn't find any evidence of them climbing up. And I also checked whether the use of C-Science, as I explained, does it yield different results, how accurate it is. So I checked through various methods so instead of keeping it as zero, uncertainty coordinate as zero, I checked for different buffers, 0.5 kilometers, 5 kilometers, and I'll be checking for further, but I didn't include that in this conference. And I found that the means are somewhat different, so this will affect how we, if you are studying effects of elevation, how elevation is correlated to some of the biological aspect of the species, then the results might change if we are using different buffers or without any uncertainty coordinates. Coordinate uncertainty. And also I checked if this distance which are extracted from the website as compared to the ones that were received through an Excel sheet, how far away are these? And I found that the means is more than 7.5, which is biologically very significant. So it can yield the wrong results when you're doing calculations with it, but not in other models like species distribution modeling, where it's not so important. That's the summary of it.
Thanks, Paul, for just explaining it. We are a little over time, so I just have one quick question, which is from Nishan. For Himalayan vagrant, are these seen only on the foothill area regions? Any chance or data for finding them in areas like Delhi?
Right. So they're not just restricted to foothills, but they can be seen somewhat, towards the interior, like Chandigarh and some places in Uttar Pradesh. They are not exactly foothills, but they are very close to foothills. You might get to see a vagrant in the coming years. I'm not sure. It's a possibility.
Okay.
Thank you.
So thank you, Paul and Vinayak, and also, we had Ajay and Piyush, very interesting talks, and I'm sure that there will be many more questions which will come to you on the channel. So please stay on and please interact with the audience, with all the participants. And we will now move on to the next session, which will start in a while, and moderating that will be Kaveri. And do stay on, please interact in the launch, and there are many more interesting things coming up. Thank you so much.